title of my paper today is Mortality Fears, Political Motivation, and Xenophobia, Resistances to Effective Immigration Policy, and Maintenance of an American Humanitarian Crisis. Now, the topic of immigration remains one of the most divisive topics in American politics and played a pivotal role in the 2016 election. Trump utilized xenophobic, explicitly racist, and fear-based rhetoric to help solidify his voting base. Hillary was not wrong to call these ardent supporters a basket of deplorables. But the chance to build the wall and calls for a Muslim registry, complete ban on all Muslims, not only spoke directly to his core base, but also brought closer to consciousness a larger, implicitly biased immigration system which Americans have denied since the 9/11 attacks. But the humanitarian crisis in immigrant detention is becoming too much for our collective denial. Well over 600,000 immigrants are detained every year, many of whom are refugees fleeing war-torn areas into, more than not, overcrowded and dangerous detention centers. Here's a, I don't know if that image is viewable, but here's just a quick picture. If you go online, you can find many pictures of the interiors of these detention centers. And this is a typical picture. We have 50 people or more housed in a room of this size. Many of these detention centers are former prisons. Without the facilities to effectively house families with children, human rights violations are numerous, including lack of adequate medical care, education for children, food, or legal counsel, disallowed religious observance, breakup of kinship networks, to name just a few. These are in direct violation of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the Refugee Convention. The U.S. Civil Rights Commission in 2015 found the abuses so egregious that the commission recommended immediate release of all families, withdrawal of all funding, and alternatives to detention. Alternatives such as the monitoring method have been found to be more effective at a rate of less than one-tenth the cost. So the monitoring method costs per person roughly about $5,000 per year, and it's over $60,000 a year to house an immigrant in a detention facility, most of which are, of course, a privately run for-profit. So the current cost, at least in 2016, is well over $2 billion for immigrant detention, over $2 billion. Despite this, there has been no political will in Congress to address this humanitarian crisis. Corrections Corporation of America and GEO Group, among other for-profit groups running detention centers, have spent millions in highly successful lobbying efforts to maintain the staggering numbers of detention facilities with an average length of stay of over 400 days per individual. They've been able to double their revenues in less than 10 years, doubling their revenues. Now, the point of today's paper, in previous papers I've delved into the special interest, I've delved into the humanitarian crisis in great detail, and that's not what I want to do today. Today I want to ask a much more psycho-historical question, which is, how is it that these special interests have so easily been able to sell us a narrative, a purely fear-based narrative, so that we remain, at least politically, in our political system, in a place where we're maintaining this humanitarian crisis? And second, of course, why is American public completely in denial about this humanitarian crisis that is happening right underneath our noses? So these are fundamentally psycho-historical questions. But what makes it even more of a psycho-historical question is that Americans' beliefs about who immigrants are does not match with reality. And it's persistent, despite the facts being put in front of somebody about who an immigrant is. We see that the fear-based narrative, that they're a threat to our physical safety, that they're a threat to our cultural dominance, they're a threat to our economic security, even though the evidence contradicts this, indicates that there are projected mechanisms at play. In psychohistorical terms, we call this delegation, right? That we are delegating to them, we are projecting into this group these violent, typically violent and aggressive tendencies. I have a quick, hopefully this will play. But Donald Trump's rhetoric during the election and then after his his inauguration as our president, his rhetoric about immigrants has exemplified this threat-based narrative. Let me get a quick bit, as much as we can stomach a presidency.
This went from sexuality to obscenity.
Why is there no sound? The sound.
When the wire got pulled out, did that change something? On the screen earlier, the wire got pulled out from the big screen.
Yeah, I flipped it back in. I don't see. On this side, I'm not getting sound.
Is the sound, do you have a Mac? You have a Mac?
No, he's saying.
Do you know?
Let's try to plug the sound directly into here instead. Oh no, I took it off altogether. All right, well, I think I will.
Here.
Oh, something's on now. That is my
daughter. That's your password.
Yeah. Well, I will paraphrase Trump, where he talks about, in very vivid terms, in this interview, he's talking about incidents of violence perpetrated by immigrants, undocumented immigrants, Americans, and he goes into one of, I think one of the examples he uses is of a military veteran who was killed by an immigrant. Now, and of course here's a quote from Trump, why is that up there? During the election, or during his campaign, that he says, quote, when Mexico sends its people, they're not sending their best, they're sending people that have lots of problems, they're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists. Direct quote from Trump. Now, this narrative, though, now this narrative that Trump was selling, and also that mostly Republican politicians have been selling. It is not for all. Not all Americans are buying this perception, right? But it is a portion of Americans that are buying this perception. So what this research that I'm seeking to do here today is really be able to pick apart the personality attributes of those who are susceptible to this threat-based message. Right? So the Trump supporters, that basket of deplorables that Clinton was talking about, is primarily a very small sliver. I couldn't say directly how many, but it was probably about 10% of Republican voters, right? So Republican voters, 50% of the population, and probably about another 10% of that, that represented what Clinton called the basket of deplorables, those who were actively involved in Stormfront and these other, you know, white supremacist sites, and these kinds of groups, and that is that basket of deplorables. So, what I was interested in is finding a testable model where we can sort of predict who are these people, right? What are the psychological characteristics, and what are the cultural contexts in which these characteristics can be sort of magnified in a way to bring someone like Trump selling this narrative, right, which at other points in our history probably would have doomed his political career, although he has this genius, I'll say, for making politically unpopular comments and getting away with it. So in the current, on the topic though of anti-immigrant sentiment, we can, you know, there's a lot of data and a lot of research on this. And so what I've done is break it up into three sort of distinct models. The first model, and this is the most long-standing model going back probably 50, 60 years, is the group threat model. And it predominantly focuses on economic variables, but on a very macro scale. If you want to know how Americans feel about immigrants, we can basically just look at how confident Americans are feeling about the economy. That model has, like a cart and a horse, right, economic feelings, economic confidence, has dragged Americans' feelings about immigrants for many, many, many years, all the way up to 9/11. And 9/11, that model completely fell apart. Economic confidence remained high for a few more years, and feelings towards immigrants became much more negative very, very quickly. So that group threat model also can include things like terrorist attacks. So what is a group threat model? It's basically a response to economic development or demographic developments. Dominant group reacts by defending power privilege to maintain social dominance. And in-group, out-group dynamics then come to the fore. And for us right now, in Trump's America, the moment we're talking now, we're looking at economic collapse, right? So the consequences of the economic collapse is another factor we have to consider when looking at any resettlement, and the demographic shifts. Right? California just announced that Latino is the number one ethnic group in the state. They are about to become the number one ethnic group in Texas. They're right on the brink. Okay. And of course, nationally, if all things stay equal, probably about 20 years or so, Latinos will be the number one ethnic group in the United States. Right? This is scary for those who have had power since the inception of this country. So that of course, that demographic shift is one of these sort of macro group threat pressures that could fuel anti-immigrant sentiment. But this functions at the group level, at the collective level. If you ask individuals, so what this means is that if you ask individuals what motivates them to have, what their feelings towards immigrants, and you go into economic concerns, it won't have an effect. You won't see an effect of economic concerns. It only works when you do large, aggregates across the culture. So if we look at how Americans are feeling in total about immigrants, and look at how Americans are feeling in total about the economy, then it seems to match up well. But as soon as you look at individual differences, it falls apart. It has no predictive value. And that's where more recent attempts to understand anti-immigrant sentiment has gone to cultural, psychological and cultural perspectives. I guess that's what we'll group them together. And this is much more an attempt to deconstruct what is happening, to look at individual differences, psychological differences, cultural belief systems. So in this model, what it is, an attempt to deconstruct immigrant sentiment by ways of normative orientations such as symbolic ideals, political culture, worldviews, collective identities, regional traditions, values, and psychological traits. So negative immigrant sentiment becomes a function of demographic changes impinging on established normative orientations, inspiring resistance to change in certain individuals. Now, from this perspective, we can now test sort of different psychological constructs and different political worldviews to see how it matches up, correlates with anti-immigrant sentiment. And we have three pieces that seem to predict anti-immigrant sentiment really, really well. One is, of course, political orientation. Okay? If you self-identify as being conservative or Republican, we can, with pretty good assurance, predict that you're going to have more negative views the more further you are on the bipolar sort of political left-right scale, the more negative you're probably going to feel. But it's not a perfect sort of predictor, because many on the political right, such as George W. Bush, are pro-immigrant. Right? The business interests in the Republican Party on the right have typically been pro-immigrant. George W. Bush was. He was tried in Texas to pro-immigrant policies. He tried at federal level pro-immigrant policies, and his party smacked him down both times, actually. On the Democrat side, we have the same thing. Unions have historically been anti-immigrant. Union members have historically been leaning towards the Democrats, and they have historically been anti-immigrant. So the political orientation is a good predictor, it's not a perfect predictor. There are some interactions in there with some other factors. Social dominance orientation. This is an interesting note. Sedanius and Prado believe that social dominance orientation is a personality characteristic. And what it is a general individual differences orientation expressing the value that people place on non-egalitarian hierarchically structured relationships among social groups. Basically, do you believe that some groups are better, more important than other groups, especially your own group? Is it better than another group? And what makes this a personality characteristic is that in the research, it pretty much stays pretty constant over time, longitudinally. Right? So if you you score on the social dominance orientation scale one way, you come back 2 years later, you're very likely to score very similarly. Although we do know context does impact this. So if you're under threat, let's say your culture is under threat, terrorist attacks, things like that, we know that social dominance orientation on the scale will increase slightly. So there is some contextual impact on this, but remains relatively stable over time. And the other factor that's highly correlated with anti-immigrant sentiment is right-wing authoritarianism. This is Alton Meyer's work. A lot of folks are probably very familiar, I hope, with Alton Meyer's right-wing authoritarianism. What it basically is another personality attribute that includes a high degree of submission to established legitimate authorities in their society, high levels of aggression in the name of their authorities, and a high level of conventionalism. Trump administration will return law and order to America. I've got the other Trump quote up here for social dominance orientation. You have to be wealthy in order to be great, right? Is a direct quote from Trump, who has, of course, just from observing him and knowing these scales pretty well, would score very highly on both these scales. These factors are probably the best predictors from the psychological and cultural perspectives in being able to predict somebody going to have very negative opinions towards immigrants. The last model is the contact model, and this is really an intervention model. And what that asserts, the contact model, which comes out of race relations research in the 60s and 1970s, that the prejudice that we experience in immigrant animosity towards immigrants is really results from stereotypes that are formed in the absence of any social contact with that outgroup. So the idea is that the more contact you have, the more it mitigates these false stereotypes, these biases that individuals hold. And if we can do so under favorable conditions, then we can sort of turn around some of these biases. And the contact model has a few problems. First and foremost, the research on implicit bias, on microaggressions, on social forms of transference. We know that people come into contact with somebody who is of a different sort of ethnicity or race, or other factors as well, even nationality, and that we bring in with us a whole slew of expectations about how they're going to behave, and then we start interacting them and treating them as if they are our expectations, right? And we know this from empirical research, this happens. And the contact model doesn't take this into consideration, this kind of confirmation bias, that you may have a very neutral interaction with somebody who's an immigrant and still walk away feeling that it was a very negative interaction, and it justifies your anger that you feel towards them. And also it implies, a motivational hierarchy, because it implies that just simple interpersonal contact can impact social level identifications in the self. For instance, Proposition 8 in California was a same-sex marriage ban, and they put it on the ballot to get rid of it. And there was a great effort, canvassing effort across the state of those who were gay, lesbian, transgender, going across the state in large numbers, house to house, to talk with voters. And the impact, according to the research, was tremendous. They were expecting once voters went to the polls to knock down Proposition 8, and guess what happened when they went to the polls? All that research was down in tubes. Even though all the research up to that point indicated that people were feeling great and that they were going to support this, the equality, it fell apart because when people go to the polls, it is not their interpersonal part of their personality that is voting, it is their group level identifications that is voting. Right. So there is contact, so the contact model is has some flaws, good points and some bad points. Now, to put this all into a single model, and this is really what my research is all about at this point, is trying to develop a testable model, a model that we can actually empirically sort of investigate using structural equation modeling to see how much of negative immigrant sentiment that we can sort of predict, how much can we explain with one single model. And the way the model actually works is it takes very seriously that these other models are all working on different levels of analysis. Right. And that there's an interaction between them. So the contextual factors, these are working on terrorism, threat perception, immigrant influx, and economic confidence. These psychocultural factors are mediating these effects. So you have this contextual events that are occurring, and then we have those psychocultural characteristics that mediates that. Okay, before it then comes to impact how people feel about immigrants. Now, what we have here is this sort of intervention level, I guess. Coming from the field of social work, we always need to have an intervention. We have to do something. We can't just say what's wrong. We also have to have a solution to deal with it. And that interpersonal factor is the contact model. But what I've done is I've changed it. At least the way that we measure the contact model to take into consideration those social forms of transference, implicit bias, microaggressions, confirmation bias that we were talking about, to take that into consideration. So what this is the contact with immigrants, which is a quantity. According to the theory, the more contact you have, the more positive feelings you'll have. And what I've added to it is a quality of contact as well, in that that it's not just important to have a lot of contact. If that's a lot of negative contact, then it won't matter. That's one of the flaws of the theory. So we're looking at a lot of contact, positive contact, right? Or contact being mediated by quality of contact, which then becomes a moderator of the model in total. It's a three-way interaction. We call that a mediated moderator. And doing the stats on that is giving me a headache. But that's the model. Now, today I was hoping to have all the findings for you, and unfortunately, like I said, the stats are giving me a huge headache. But I want to look at some of the information that we have so far, some of the preliminary findings. Number one, we have good correlations across many of these important variables. Okay, terrorism fears, so some of the higher ones, terrorism fears, okay, highly significant, you know, not a very strong R at 0.322, but nonetheless for a larger model. Significant in our case. Immigrant influx, right? No relationship, not a significance, approaching significance, but really even the R is so small, it doesn't seem important. Part of the problem is I've probably measured it wrong. We measured it the best way we possibly could, given the context of a survey study like this. We measured it by looking at getting participants, county of residence. We have, well, I should have said, the participants for this is, American residents, 1,005 of them across the country, representing every state in the country. So it's the best sample we could possibly get without paying like $30,000 or $40,000 for a nationally representative sample. And I don't have that money, and no one was willing to give me that money. And I think if I tried to pay that money, it would have killed me. So what do you think? I had to go through actually and document immigrant influx per county of where their residence is, okay, to get this sort of number. Is it visible? Is it too small?
I'm getting a glare.
Okay. Is this better? So that really didn't have much of an impact. It only was slightly correlated with contact, and you think the two of them would be highly correlated. It was only slightly correlated. So there's something there with that measurement that we have to pick apart. One of the ways we could probably try to fix it is look at it as a proportion. Right? So look at the immigration rates as a proportion of the overall population, which might give us better take on contact, right? If you have a large population, and then you have a relatively large immigrant population, you're going to have less contact than if you have that same population in a city half the size, let's say, right? So that might be one way we can sort of work with that. Economic confidence, again, highly correlated, the significance, highly significant correlation. Again, a small correlation, negative correlation, which means that the more confident one was in the economy, the higher negative feelings towards immigrants was going, right? So again, this goes with the group threat model, right, the prediction. DTA, I didn't talk too much about it in this model because I can't test it yet because it is a mediator of terror. Terrorism fears, and I didn't get to testing this yet, but for the overall model, I put it in. It's not supposed to, according to the model, be directly correlated with negative attitudes and immigrants. So that doesn't matter. Political orientation, one of our largest correlations, 0.605, highly significant. We knew that going in, that was a prediction, that's there. Social dominance orientation, also highly correlated. We knew that going in from the previous research. Right-wing authoritarianism, also highly correlated. All these are in the correct direction too, which is important. And contact, highly significant, negatively correlated, slight negative correlation. Again, this is in the direction we would have predicted. And quality of contact, though, this is interesting here, is that in this, because we're interested in looking at this as an intervention model of how to intervene in these false perception of biases. And that, of course, is in the correct direction, highly significant correlation too. When we run a simple linear regression on this, so we add this all into one model, not just we get individual correlations, but we put this into a model, what we see is that we do get a significant regression equation, right? So it is highly significant at 0.001. And the R squared, I'm sorry, the SWAY program doesn't allow me to put a square of 0.668, which means that we are actually, with this simple regression model, predicting 67% of the variance of the negative attitudes towards immigrants, with just the simple model. And this isn't even taken into consideration then all of these complicated sort of relationships and interactions that we have in the model. So just a simple regression is getting us already 67% of the variance, which I think is pretty good. For psychological research, that's pretty good. That's not bad. But what we see when we put it all together is that contact, so this one here, you'll notice that it no longer reaches significance. So once we factor in those other factors, it no longer has significance in the model. Probably better to just take it out of the model altogether, one would think. But theoretically, that doesn't make sense, right? Because we know that, you know, that it does have a correlation. It just tells us that there's something going on here, which is already predicted, right? But that contact is not correlated now because we're factoring in another factor, which is which probably impacting it, is the quality of that contact. So we can test that too. Is that true? So do we have an interaction or a mediation going on? And we can test that by looking at we need to have these three sort of we need to fit these three sort of requirements to tell if there is mediation. First thing, does contact predict or is it related to, theoretically predict, negative attitudes towards immigrants? And yes, we have the positive correlation. We have R squared, this should be R squared. this program converts R squared into R2. I apologize for that. Of 0.02, so it is significant, but it is a very small effect. It's 0.2% of the variance it predicts. But it still is significant, and it is only a small piece of the model. Does contact predict quality? That's not quite the language we use, that we want to use here, but not quite accurate, really. Is contact related to quality? And it is, again, 0.07 R squared, and a significant effect here as well. So that fits the requirement. The next requirement, contact and quality of contact predicts negative attitudes towards immigrants. So as a combined model, we have now an R squared of 0.41. So now just this intervention model has 41% of the variance that it predicts in the negative attitudes towards immigrants. So now just this part of the model, once we start this part here, we start looking at interactions, we're already increasing significantly the predictive value of the model. Last part, let's see. Once we factor in quality of contact, do we see that contact itself lessens in its prediction of negative attitudes of immigrants? And as I mentioned before, we do see that it no longer reaches significance once we factor in quality. So there's a really good argument here that at least in this part or portion of the model, right, the intervention portion, that we're onto something here. It's possibly, at least, from this research, possibly we can develop sort of intervention models from this perspective. But there's a lot more to do here. But I think what the value of this psychohistorically, number one, this is inspired psychohistorically. This research really comes from the basic sort of question of why do we have certain individuals in our society who are so susceptible to the negative immigrant or the immigrant threat narrative. And the second piece is, well, how do then we study that, right? How do, that's a psychohistorical question, why? But it's more of an empirical question, I think. Who are they? Who are these individuals? Here is a model, at least a general model, where we can start taking seriously that kind of question. We can do this research relatively cheaply. It's a couple $1,000 for, to do the survey stuff, and you can actually do this research. So I think that Mackey-Stewart provides a framework for finding these kinds of questions out. Psychohistorically, when we talk about delegation, it's sort of been a sort of a basic sort of principle of psychohistorical research in the past. And again, this could help in understanding pulling apart those subsections of the population that we believe are delegated to another group, have these misperceptions, these biases. Hopefully I'll have the full research out, and hopefully Bert will publish it, I'm hoping.
I was just going to make it up.
Yeah.